have to send them to the liver or the muscle or the kidney or wherever else they're being processed and used. Now, as I said, we're going to get to most of this later. It will migrate to the apical membrane of the enterocytes when SGLT1 capacity is exceeded, right? So SGLT1 has a really low KN, which means it's going to be saturated at low concentrations. So when we saturate, if we eat a sugar-rich meal, we have to have an additional way to take this in. And one of the ways we do that is by using GLUT2, which has a higher KN, but if you've got so much sugar in the lumen, it doesn't matter that it doesn't have as good an affinity for any one substrate. There's so much substrate, it's going to work anyway. Okay, but we don't waste our energy bringing it all the way up unless there's a reason. And again, we'll talk about how that gets signaled later. Okay, GLUT5. GLUT5 only does fructose. The difference between fructose, of course, is where our C double bond O is, right? So this one's probably specific for a non-terminal C double bond O. So it transports fructose across the apical membrane into the enterocyte. It can also be at that basolateral membrane and send fructose out. So we've got some redundancy, right? We have multiple transport proteins that can bring in each hexose and multiple transport proteins that can send them out. That's because without ATP, those of you who know Dr. Tam, you die, okay?
ATP,
yeah,
zero, you die.
Yes, if we can't get the sugar in and turn it into ATP, nothing works. It's just straight breakdown. So we want to have as much redundancy as possible in the system, so evolutionarily, those who have redundancy survive to reproduce, which means that the redundancy has persisted in the population. You look at us as, I'm a big population genetics person, so we're not going to depersonalize too much, but that's the idea. Okay, alright, so then GLUT7. It's present at the apical membrane, transports fructose and glucose. They're not really sure. I don't know what distal mall or intestinal mall is. I don't know why I wrote that. I'll have to go back and look. I'm sure it's a weird thing. It probably auto-corrected something that I meant to write. Small. I'm sure it just Now I know exactly what I'm talking about. Okay, so most of this digestion is taking place in the jejunum. When you get to the ileum, most of these things are not expressed. So if you've got, when we talk later about secondary malabsorption syndrome, or if you've had a gastric bypass, you bypass the jejunum, or you've had damage or removal, this one can be expressed in increased concentrations in the ileum because it allows you to take up sugar that you might have missed. It's another redundancy in the system. If you're sensing high sugar in the small intestine, then once you get all the way down to the ileum where there shouldn't be sugar because the jejunum should have already done its job of absorbing that, this can be expressed to try and catch what's left. Okay. So let's highlight that. So you should know which glute's found where. I don't care about specific hands. Alright? I don't.
So you said the GLUT2, well, all of them are found in the jejunum, but...